you have it set. Welcome, beloved friends and family of John Schwartz. I am the Reverend Chantel Nelson. We have gathered for this hour and a half together to honor, to celebrate, to remember. I am joined here in the home of John by his loving parents, Gary and Arlene, and his beloved sister and her husband, Amy and Mark. Of course, we also cannot forget John's beloved Mongo, who is here with us. For indeed, all creatures great and small bow before the Lord. It is only fitting that she be with us this day. John entered this life on October 22nd of 1970. He took his eternal rest on November 15th, 2020. John is survived not only by his parents and beloved sister and brother-in-law, but he is also survived by his centenarian grandmother, Marie. Numerous aunts, uncles, cousins, friends, and of course, those whom he served. John accomplished much in his short 50 years here on this earth. We invite you to visit the obituary page that the family has set up for John at a later time so that you may read more fully some of what John did in his life. We ask that you leave a note for the family, perhaps sharing how you met John, sharing how knowing John impacted your life, sharing words of encouragement. His family is indeed reading your notes, your emails, and they are taking comfort from your words. Please continue to share. There are many ways in which to celebrate the life of a loved one. Today's service will include prayer. It will include readings. It will include song. And it will include words of hope. Let us now continue our time together with a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give thanks for those who have gathered this day to honor, remember, and celebrate the life of John Schwartz. Their loving presence reflects the love that John poured into each of them. We pray that the love of the many who are present brings comfort to John's family. We know in your holy word in the book of Ecclesiastes, you tell us, there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. Time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. In this time of mourning, we pray for your loving comfort and peace, trusting that joy will come again. We hold this trust, O God, because of the promise of the beloved Son, Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that God gave the beloved Son, the one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. We remember the beloved Son as we indeed prepare to remember John. We ask those of you who have been able to gather candles, if you would bring them forth now, to remember the light of the beloved Son. As we gather our candles, we continue in prayer, O God. We pray that although we are in many dwellings, though we are in many places across your vast creation, that your Holy Spirit comes. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill each home, each heart. Dwell within each candle with the light of Christ. Let us now light our candles, trusting that the light that will be present is not only the light of the beloved Holy Spirit, but also the light which shines from John's spirit eternal. Though his body is no longer with us, the love will always remain. Relight your candle at this time. As we continue to light our candles and the light indeed grows, may our hearts be filled with the love of John that spreads not only within his home at this time, but within your homes, within your hearts, and forever in your lives. Among John's many loves was music. One of his favorite bands was the Beatles. As we listen now to Let It Be, let us give thought to the life of John. And when the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be, let it be. We now will have a reading from John's cousin entitled, God Saw You Getting Tired. Hear now from Lisa Johnson.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now, Lisa. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. This is a poem. It's an adaptation of a poem by Francis and Kathleen Coelho. You strove to live the fullest life. You traveled the world round. But this illness, it was relentless, and you were forced to give up ground. God saw you getting tired, and a cure was not to be. So he put his arms around you and whispered, come to me. With tearful eyes, we watched you as you slowly slipped away. And though we loved you dearly, we couldn't make you stay. And when we saw you sleeping so peaceful and free from pain, we could not wish you back to suffer that again.
Thank you, Lisa. Peaceful and free from pain indeed, and for that we give thanks. Let us now enjoy another musical selection entitled The Sound of Silence.
Darkness, my own friend, I've come to talk with you again, because a vision softly creeping left its scenes while I was sleeping, and the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone, narrow streets of cobblestone, beneath the halo of a street lamp, I turned my collar to the cold and damp. When my eyes were stared by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence. And in the naked light I saw 10,000 people, maybe more. People talking without speaking, people hearing without listening, people writing songs, and voices never shared, and no one dared the sound of silence. Fool said I, you do not know. Silence like a cancer grows. Hear my words and I might teach you. Take my arms and I might reach you. But my words like silent raindrops fell and echoed in the wind.
Refugees, the poor, the people talking without speaking. He saw that people heard their voices, but did not fully listen to their needs. And John acted. He acted to meet the needs of the people. John donated over 1,000 hours of pro bono work to the Human Rights Initiative by representing asylum seekers from Zimbabwe, Egypt, Nepal, Rwanda, Pakistan, and the Congo. In recognition of his efforts, he was awarded the prestigious Angel of Freedom, the highest honor given by the Human Rights Initiative. In the silence, let us hear John's words that they might teach us. Do not just hear, but listen. May his arms that reached out to the least among us now reach us and encourage us to continue to be in service to those in need. Let us seek to disturb the silence as John did. Let us be good and faithful disciples as John's life was. Blessed be. We will now have a second reading from the 23rd Psalm from John's godmother, Diane Ludwig. Ludwig, I think we can hear you.
Okay. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul.
He guides me along the right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Indeed, we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever because of God's amazing grace. Reading by Ron Schwartz, John's godfather, from John 14th chapter, verses 1 through 4.
A reading from John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going.
The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. If I speak in the tongues of humankind or of angels, but do not have love. I am only a resounding gong or clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all that I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. For now we see only as a reflection, as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. I offer to you that reading from 1 Corinthians 13th chapter. I am indeed honored to stand before John's parents and his sister and brother-in-law and Mongo. I am indeed honored to stand before you. I must confess to you that my heart is somewhat heavy and saddened. As John's beloved family shared with me the light of this incredible human being, I got to know John only in part. I truly wish that I had had the opportunity to meet him in person. During his 50 years of living, John made it his mission to bring joy and to share love with as many people as he could. He affirmed the gifts that others possessed. He loved and was loved dearly by family and friends, by his clients. His love, his many loves, included traveling. Perhaps that love of traveling came at a young age for John, as his family moved about and as they traveled the country. In moving with his family and traveling with his family, he had the opportunity to learn about America and our very rich history. He learned that America truly is a cornucopia of personalities and culture, cornucopia of diversity, and John, welcome. John enjoyed playing trombone in high school and being a drum major. It was after high school that he attended Rice University and continued with his music, but also pursued degrees in history and philosophy. After graduating from Rice, John decided to do what any young man would do. He went backpacking through Europe for a bit. Again, a country rich in history and beauty. Upon returning, John enrolled in the University of Texas School of Law, where he earned his Juris Doctorate. John, lover of people and travel and knowledge, smart, determined, and quite humble. He had a huge thirst for what was beyond what he already knew. His love of history, perhaps, was a guiding light that humanity should learn from its past and do all within our power to create an even better future. We were to bring forward the good from the past in order to build up all the more better. It is because of this, perhaps, that John dedicated his life to serving. Not only as an attorney, but he volunteered for various organizations such as the Human Rights Initiative, but also shared a concern for all of creation and volunteering for Operation Kindness as well. As I stated, his volunteerism with the Human Rights Initiative led to the Angel of Freedom Award for him. That award meant more to him than any other. Again, John dared to disturb the silence. He dared to not only hear the clamoring voices for help, but he listened. He listened to the people crying out. That award represented for him the change that is possible when we seek to do life intentionally, which is what John did. He was intentional in helping those who had endured abuses that pain us just to hear about. We cannot fathom experiencing some of the things that asylum seekers experienced in their quest to get here. John steeled himself to not only hear their stories, but to be their champion. This Angel of Freedom Award meant that not only was he helping the individual, he was helping their families as well. Though their bodies and their minds will forever hold the scars of their past, their heart now holds on to hope, a gift given to them by the work, the love, the service of John Schwartz. A generous spirit, a generous heart. It is easy to become depleted when one is so generous in spirit and heart. It is important to take care of oneself and to find ways in which to recharge and renew, to pour hope back into oneself. John had his own interests. He enjoyed running. He completed marathons on each of the seven continents by the age of 40. He completed 5 Ironman triathlons across the United States and was on track to complete a marathon in each of the United States by the age of 50 before becoming ill. He made it to 42 of those states. His sister Amy and brother-in-law Mark were able to join him at times, cheering him on, meeting him at the finish line. A simple act, but an act of love that poured back into John as he had poured himself out. A reminder of the love that was present for him in this life. A reminder of who he was as brother, as friend, as disciple of God. Think about the lives that John had the opportunity to touch. On each of those continents and within each of the states that he visited, take a moment to think about your own lives. To put this in perspective, I want you to think about your own life. Remember the stranger that helped you get your bags to the car. Remember the stranger who helped protect you from the rain by sharing their umbrella. Remember the stranger who smiled at you. The person you met at a random football game that you never saw again. People whose names we never knew, but whose memories we hold dear. The simple, kind act that they shared with us. Think about all the times that John did those things. We will not know in this life the many people his simple acts touched. But we know that they did. We know that they did. John traveled. He touched with his humor, his warm smile, and his humble intellect. But John did not just travel as a tourist runner who had chance encounters with people. I'm told that he was quite the meticulous planner. He researched and he studied and he knew where he was going and he planned his visits. He wanted to learn about the people, not from books, not from TV, not from what others told him. He wanted to learn through the experience of being present with them. John wanted to know about their culture. He wanted to know about their families and their faith. He wanted to know about their everyday lives. He wanted to know their story, and so he went and he visited churches and museums. He dared to not just stay safe in certain areas, but he went beyond the gates of his hotel. He went to where the people were. He dared to not just hear the noise, but he listened to them. He saw their needs, and he returned home to make a difference for those who would find their way here. He wanted to learn the best way that one can learn, through a simple hello. How are you today? Hello. Tell me what you're cooking for your family today. strong, determined, fiercely independent. John knew who he was as a person, but he never tried to force himself on anyone. He met people where they were and he accepted them there. Humility, quiet confidence, those are words that describe John Schwartz. He was determined not to live his life in vain. He brought his light to the dim and dark places, and he helped others to find their light in turn. John's life was filled with many different seasons. Winter, in which he saw the ugliness and the emptiness of humanity. Spring, in which he saw the pregnant possibilities of hope for a better world. Summer, in which he saw that which he had labored so hard for continue to grow in the light. And fall, in which he saw the beauty of change. The beauty of letting go of what was so that something new indeed could develop. A new season would come. To everything, there indeed is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what was planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. During this, your season of mourning and weeping, it is the life and light of John that will help you to share in the stories which will prayerfully fill the void that has been left, which will prayerfully help with your healing, and hopefully will help you to one day laugh again. Some of you will undoubtedly laugh the next time there is a blue moon, or you hear the song Blue Moon. That is a private joke among John's family and some of his high school friends. Perhaps others of you know the story of the blue moon. Perhaps you'll smile as you watch a Star Wars film and remember how much John loved them. May the Schwartz be with you. Or as you see someone walking their border collie, you will reflect upon John's love for his beloved Mongo. Joy will come again. It is in remembering these qualities and these loves of John that perhaps we can hear him say, live your life in service. Live your life and be happy. I will always be with you. I am in the sunrise to welcome you in a new day. I am in the wind to caress you and call your name. I am in the running, babbling brook, laughing to bring you joy. I am in the dancing flames of fire to warm your heart with memories. I am in the flowers that bloom to share my smile with you. I am in the evergreens to remind you that my spirit is always, always with you. I am in the sunset to ease you out of the day and relax. I am in the moon to watch over you as you sleep. Wherever you are, my spirit is with you, loving you always. To the Schwartz family, you are not alone today. Your grief is shared by those who are joining with us through the gift of technology. They have gathered with you in remembering the beautiful son that you raised, the wonderful brother who shared life with you. They will help you to remember the funny, loving stories of John, the humble spirit who will always be with you in your heart. Although you may grieve differently, you are all learning to live in a new normal. The common thread is that you know the price of love. Love affirms for us that death does not have the final say. With love, there is always hope. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up as indeed you are doing. Remember, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Take heart in what will be a new normal for you as your life now is one that holds both grief and love. A great American poet, Robert Frost, said this. In three words, I can sum up everything I've learned about life. It goes on. It goes on. In this new normal, continue to trust, continue to hope. Trust that beyond his physical absence, there is presence of spirit. Trust that beyond the pain, healing will come. That beyond the brokenness, you will mend and be whole again. That beyond the silence, there may be words. That through understanding, there is love. The late great Bible commentator Matthew Henry spoke of such eternal love and hope, anticipating that some would grieve heavily his passing. He wrote these words of comfort and assurance. Perhaps we can hear these words spoken in John's voice. Would you like to know where I am? I am at home in my Father's house, in the dwelling prepared for me. I am where I want to be. No longer on the stormy sea, but in God's safe, quiet harbor. My sowing time is done, and I am now reaping. My joy is at the joy of harvest. Would you like to know how it is with me? I am made perfect and whole again. Would you like to know what I am doing? I see God not as through a glass darkly, but now face to face. I am engaged in the sweet enjoyment of my precious Redeemer. I am singing hallelujahs to the one who sits upon the throne. And I am constantly praising God. Today, let us find hope and reassurance, not only in Matthew Henry's words, but in the promise of the gospel reading from John read earlier. John is now at home in the place that was prepared for him by Jesus Christ, the one and only beloved Son, whose promise to us is salvation, eternal life. It is there that John joins with ancestors, his grandparents, perhaps friends who have gone before him, in that great cloud of witnesses. In that we can take heart. There is the good news. Let not your hearts be troubled. Neither let them be afraid. Let your faith this day and all the days to come be a reassurance of the hope of life eternal and the love which awaits us and will greet us there. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Amen. We give thanks that there are those who have agreed to share a few words about who John was and will remain to them. We will have words from Lou Strubik. I apologize, Lou, if I mispronounced your last name. He is a co-worker of John's. Hear now these words from Lou.
Thank you, Chantel. I think I finally figured this out.
Yes.
Arlene, Gary, Amy, and Mark, thanks so much for the privilege and honor of saying a few words and sharing some remembrances about John. I'm sure that Arlene was a little bit hesitant to ask a lawyer to say a few words about John, because those few words always turn into a lot more, because lawyers have a tendency to have big egos and they like to hear themselves talk. That wasn't the case with John. And as Chantel so aptly pointed out in that really nice presentation, John was the exception to the rule when it came to lawyers being able to manage egos. John was humble to a fault, self-effacing, the consummate team player. He was the kind of guy that got more joy out of helping to prepare something and letting other people take the credit than actually taking the credit himself. And so I had always thought that all of John's characteristics were the epitome of somebody who was raised in the Midwest. The Midwest work ethic, keeping your head down, just persevering and being humble. And the hardworking aspect of this is exemplified by the fact that 5 days before John passed away, he was on a Zoom call with me and a couple of other work colleagues helping to prepare for a case that we were getting ready to file. And I mean, that kind of epitomizes John. As sick as John was, he wanted to help out until the very end, and he did. There's so much about John that I and I'm sure others really never knew. I mean, he considered himself, but would never tell anybody, probably to be the consummate Renaissance man. And I had no idea just what kind of a Renaissance man he really was, at least not the full picture, until I had a chance to visit with Arlene and Gary and Amy and Mark last week. I mean, I knew about John's having traveled the world. I knew about John's having sipped beer in monasteries outside of Munich, Germany. I knew about John having run marathons in every continent. I knew about John having done 5 triathlons. But what I didn't know was that John started out, as Chantel mentioned in her sermon, as a music major at Rice University. And when I was talking to Arlene about all that, she said to me the reason that John decided to give up being a music major is because he was afraid that something could happen where he couldn't always play the trombone. And so that started the process of John's gradual segue over into the law. And I can tell you that no one was happier that he chose that path than myself and all of his colleagues at Norton Rose Fulbright. Also didn't realize that John had spent his formative years growing up in Texas. I had always assumed that all happened in Wisconsin because he remained fiercely loyal to his Green Bay Packers. And I'm proud to say, John, that you didn't throw away your Packer allegiance and sign up with one of those Texas teams. That was one of the many things that I admired about you. And the other thing I didn't realize about John was the thousands of hours that he donated to Operation Kindness, and asylum seekers, and other charitable causes. It makes people like myself pale in comparison when you realize how much John gave back and how happy he was to give back. John got me in a little bit of trouble, as I told Arlene, with my wife not all that long ago, because my wife had become a big fan of the eggs that John raised with the chickens that he had in the backyard. And so it wasn't too long ago that I was trying to explain to my wife how we were not going to be like John Schwartz and construct a chicken coop in our backyard. And Arlene, thanks again for the offer to sell me that chicken coop at a discount. But I think that I'll stay where I am and not try to do what John did in terms of raising chickens. There's one story that I want to tell about John that I told John's family, and I think it ties in nicely with the kind of person that John was and what I expect to be a beaming St. Peter waiting at the pearly gates to admit John. My office was situated down the hall from John's, and so John would have to walk by my office several times a day on his way to the break room and the restroom. And John had a gait about him, and those of us who knew John know what I'm talking about. And you would see John walking down the hall, and it was like every step that John was taking looked like it was a major endeavor. And for a guy that ran all these marathons and triathlons, it was very difficult to understand. And I joked with John a lot about that, and that was just kind of the way that John walked. And so I had this image in my head about John approaching St. Peter at the pearly gates, ambling up to the gates with that gait that was signature John, having St. Peter throw open the gates. John gets inside the gates, and St. Peter says to him, John, welcome, but listen, you got to stop running all these marathons. It's time to relax a little bit. So to Arlene and Gary and Amy and Mark, God bless, and John, may you rest in peace.
Thank you so very much, Lou, for those kind words. We will now hear from John's friend, Liz Boydston.
Can you hear me? This is Liz Boydston.
Yes, we can hear you, Liz. Thank you.
Thank you so much for letting me speak today. So John's and my friendship began, I think, really because I forced him to be my friend. Those who know me know that pretty much tracks. I don't really wait for people to invite me into their lives. I kind of put myself in your life, especially if you intrigue me in the ways that John did. So beginning my very first day at the law firm, I went into John's office and I sat in one of the chairs across from his desk. And he looked up at me with this face that read very plainly, like, what in the world is this woman doing in my office? And I started doing that every single day. I walked into his office every single day and I just talked to him. I'd ask him questions. At first it was like pulling teeth to get to know John. He was very quiet and he kept to himself and he wasn't in a small talk. So I changed what I was talking to him about. And I started asking about music and restaurants. And then I started picking up the things in his office and asking about those things. And that's when I found out about his goal of running a marathon every continent. And I was floored. He was such an intriguing person to me. And getting him to really open up to me was a journey. He was such a quirky person that I wanted to get to know him and I wanted him in my life. And John had all these ways. He ate lunch at the same time every day. He got coffee the same times every day. And so I noticed that at 3 p.m. every day, he'd go down to the Starbucks and get his afternoon coffee. So I started showing up at his office 3 minutes before and being like, hey, you wanna go get coffee? And we'd walk together, sometimes talking, but most of the time in complete silence. Because John was the master of the comfortable silence. He never just spoke to speak. He was quite content to sit with you or stay with you or just walk with you and say nothing, just being in your presence. And it was 6 months, literally every day for 6 months on every workday, I would walk into John's office and either we'd go get coffee or we'd talk for 15 or 20 minutes. And after 6 months at the firm, I had my very first trial. And I was so busy and I had no idea what I was doing. And so I was just like trying to figure out what to do. And I did not go to John's office. And I don't know how long it had been, but one day John walks into my office, sits down on the chairs in front of me. And he goes, you haven't come to my office in days. And I knew at that moment that our friendship had become real, that my presence in his life meant something and that he truly enjoyed our time together. And so that started what we did every day was we would talk for hours. We would not be billing during those hours most of the time. We just talked for hours about, you know, the places that he had been and, you know, the things that he was doing and the marathon he was running or the Ironman. And we talked about food and I'd invite him to my house and I'd cook food and with him. And it was just, we just learned a lot about each other. And I'd been working at the firm less than a year when I learned how powerful travel and experiencing new cultures was. And I learned that from John. John and a colleague of ours, Mike Englund, and I took summer associates to one of the bankruptcy section's go-to lunch places, Bangkok City. And it's just three of us who know each other and then three strangers. These law students who are trying to land a job at the firm. And John loathed these. He loathed small talk. He hated these lunches, but I begged him to come with me. And so we're halfway through lunch and the subject of travel comes up. And it was like a switch. John was so engaged and he was leading the conversation and he was talking about all these things that he saw and the people he met and the flavors of the foods that he tasted and the places he'd gone and what his next trip was. And it is that moment in June of 2010 that my eyes were opened. The way John's eyes lit up and the stories he was enthusiastically telling, it made me need, like deep inside of me, need to do those things. And starting that year, 2010, just a few months later, I went on my first real trip to Turkey. And it was truly life-changing. And I wanted to bring something back for John to thank him for showing me just through how much travel had changed him that I had to do this. And I brought him back an evil eye that year. And that began this goofy trinket exchange that John and I had for 9 years. Anytime here I went on trips, he and I would bring each other back something. At first they were traditional, you know, like a Buddha from Japan. And then they became the goofiest thing we could find. And he specifically went out of his way in Germany to go to Dresden to go to the German Hygiene Museum just so that he could bring me something that I had to put on my wall that said German Hygiene Museum. And that's just kind of the way that John and my relationship was. He was such this goofball and I just loved him so much. And there were so many countries. Like I said, 2010 was my first real trip abroad. By 2019, I have been to 26 countries and John has been to so many more. And you can imagine what my shelves look like and John's shelves looked like. They were covered in random trinkets from our many countries and continents. And each time I see that shelf, I smile and I'm so grateful that I got to know John and that I was there that day in June of 2010 when I witnessed the power of travel experienced through John's house. John and I helped each other plan vacations and we'd spend hours talking with each other. And we spent hours at the patio of Cane Rosso with his dog Mongo over bowls of ramen. And we just planned each other's trips. In 2017, we were heatedly debating whether it was truly okay for John to take a 20-day vacation. And I convinced him that yes, it was, because we were in the middle of Adeptus that year and we were both billing out the wazoo and that he could absolutely take a 20-day vacation because he was going to Myanmar to do this amazing marathon. And he did it. And then right after he was diagnosed, John and I were sitting in Cane Rosso or outside on the patio. And I asked him, you know, what was the one thing I had to do that of course wasn't a marathon because I don't think I own the muscles necessary to run a marathon. And we were sitting on the patio drinking a new local beer and waiting for our honey bastard pizzas. And John sat there thinking, and then he told me it was when he rode a hot air balloon over the Maasai Mara National Park in Kenya. And he was at nearly a loss for words to describe how incredible it was. And in that moment, he made me promise to go to Kenya and ride a hot air balloon of the Maasai Mara National Park. And that's my promise to you, John. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Liz. We appreciate you sharing your special friendship. We will now hear from John's cousin, Lori.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, Lori. Thank you.
Thank you for the honor of letting me speak today. I've looked up to my cousin John for as long as I can remember. When we were kids, it was John's sense of humor that I admired. As adults, I've admired John's intelligence, his sense of adventure, and life experiences. And the thing is, John is so willing to go out of his way to share these qualities with others. A year ago, John and I got talking about an upcoming trip my husband Andy and I would be taking later that summer. Most people would maybe send a list of 5 or 6 recommendations of sites to see. Not John. John wrote me a detailed 2-page email of things to see and do in Amsterdam and helpful hints to get around the city. What a gift John's words were to me. I could see these sites without even being there. And I knew I wanted to go and do the things that John had done. Another thing I've admired is John's amazing accomplishments. I've told countless people about my amazing cousin who's run marathons on every continent and almost all 50 states and numerous Ironmans. I am so grateful that I was able to witness John compete in one in the Madison, Wisconsin Ironman in 2012. All day as John swam, biked, and ran, I kept thinking, what strength, what perseverance. I'm exhausted just watching. And John did it with a smile. He would wave as he's passing us by and kept going. I also want to share a few thoughts from my husband, Andy. When Andy moved to Texas, the Schwartz family treated him as one of their own. That included John. Andy has great memories of going to watch John march in the Marching Owl Band, AKA the Mob, at Rice University. Their shows were always entertaining and usually better than the game themselves. Afterwards, we would go to one of John's finds, Star Pizza, for some of the best pizza Andy ever had. One of Andy's most vivid memories of John was when they went to a blues concert in the Woodlands. They enjoyed listening to the amazing acts, including Buddy Guy and B.B. King, but the best was talking to John, between and during the acts, about the show, other concerts they had been to, and life in general. Andy felt a genuine connection to John, and that didn't change when we moved back to Wisconsin. John, you have been a blessing to so many. Rest in peace.
Thank you. I would like to say thank you to Lou, Liz, and Lori. As I prepare to offer our closing prayer, on behalf of the Schwartz family, I would like to thank each and every one of you for joining with us today. Truly, it has been a source of comfort for this family. We want to remind you, for those of you who live locally, that there will be a drive, I hate to say drive-by, because we are in Dallas, but for lack of a better word, one of the lawyers can correct me later, but there will be a drive-by wake, if you will. The family is going to place a basket on the porch so that those of you who live locally, if you would like to come and place a card in the basket on the porch, again, your words are bringing a great deal of comfort to this family. Please come by this afternoon. I forgot the time of it. At 2 o'clock.
2 to 4.
2 to 4. From 2 to 4 p.m. this afternoon here at John's house. If you live locally and would like to come and drop off a note in the basket on the porch, please, please do so. Again, they are reading your emails and your words of comfort. As was stated in John's obituary, the family is asking that in lieu of flowers, you please consider making a donation to the Kidney Cancer Association or the Human Rights Initiative or to Operation Kindness. Each of these organizations held importance in John's life. Following the closing prayer, I would like to ask that you remain online as the family has put together for your viewing a slideshow of pictures from some of John's travels. So let us pray. Blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted. O God, our strength and redeemer, giver of life and conqueror of death, we praise you with humble hearts. With faith in your great mercy and wisdom, we entrust John Schwartz to your eternal care. We praise you for your steadfast love for him all the days of his earthly life. We thank you for all that he was to those who loved him. God, you are our refuge and our fortress. Your holy word promises us that you are close to the brokenhearted and you rescue those whose spirits are crushed. We place our hope in you, God of all mercies and all comfort, in tender love and compassion. Embrace your sorrowing children. We thank you especially that in the night of our grief and in the shadows of our sorrow, we are not left to ourselves. We have the light of your promises to sustain and comfort us. We ask your divine mercy, O God, for the family and friends of John. In due season, turn their mourning into gladness and grant them comfort and joy instead of sorrow. Through their tears, give them vision to see in faith the consolation you intend for them. Show them again the love of Christ that passes all human understanding. For by death, Christ has conquered death, and and by rising, Christ has opened to all of us the gates of everlasting life. Thanks be to you, O God. Amen. Now let us look with hope to the bright side of life.
Some things in life are bad, they can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, don't grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps, just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. Hey.
Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the bright side of life.
For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your seat, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance anyhow.
So always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath.
Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show. Keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And
always look on the bright side of life.
It's available in the foyer. Someone's got to live as well, you know. All right, it's a lot. Let's get this place up there. He changed his manner within 3 weeks. Do you think baseball is rubbish? I never made the money back, you know. I told him. I said to him, Bernie, I said, they'll never make that money back.
Thank you very much for coming along. Thank you.
Some things in life are bad.